One interesting therapeutic potential that you are conducting one of your studies is the use of psilocybin in the treatment of nicotine dependence, which seems kind of counterintuitive. Could you talk a little bit about that study?
Yes. So back in the 1950s and 60s, there were several studies done primarily with LSD in treatment of alcoholism. And those studies were done in a way that is very difficult to interpret the validity of their results according
their
to our own, partly methodology, partly how they handle the data. So given the experience we had with psilocybin at Johns Hopkins, we thought we would put together an intervention to look at addictions. We picked cigarette smoking because we thought it was an interesting form of addiction. In some ways, it's a pure addiction. It's unencumbered by the kind of social and physiological consequences you have with severe alcoholism, for instance, or heroin addiction or cocaine addiction. Yet, it's the most pernicious form of addiction that we have worldwide. And people who are dependent on tobacco, you can ask them, it's not an easy drug to quit. So we've mounted a pilot study. We've enrolled about 15 people to date, and the results look very promising. We don't have a control group, but the results that we're seeing to date is that the great majority of our people are entirely abstinent from cigarette smoking. So how does this work? How does a single session, or in this case, two or three sessions with psilocybin get people to quit smoking? Well, it's embedded, the psilocybin session is embedded in the context of a cognitive behavioral therapy for cigarette smoking cessation. So prior to the psilocybin session, people learn about cognitive behavioral approaches for smoking. They end up charting the number of cigarettes they take. They rate their urges, their cravings, they note the situation under which they smoke, they look at the reflexive and kind of habitual pattern in which they reach for a cigarette. So we're introducing a level of mindfulness into their cigarette smoking that then when combined with the psilocybin session, and for reasons we don't fully understand, really result in people being able to walk away from their addiction. What people will very often report is a transformed relationship to smoking. That before the psilocybin session, smoking held a saliency for them that was much larger than their ability to cope with. That they were addicted, they knew they were addicted, they couldn't stop their cravings, they were hooked. And with the expansive form of consciousness that can come about with psilocybin, and when the intentionality is brought into the session to really deeply look and heal, people walk away from that session with this renewed sense of self-efficacy, realizing that they're autonomous beings, that they can watch moods and cravings and habitual patterns come up into their field of consciousness, but they can choose not to act on those. So it's not a magic bullet. It doesn't take away the cravings. It doesn't take away the habitual tendency to maybe want a cigarette, but they can reframe it in a way that for many of them seems really quite magical. It's like, oh, you know, it's like Dorothy in her shoes in the Wizard of Oz. She didn't know she had been wearing them the whole time.
Right.
And it's that sense of efficacy that people come away with. We think mechanistically it might have to do with increased enhancement of executive function. That's kind of a catchphrase for how we can organize our cognitions and behaviors, you know, in real time. So that's what we have today. We're ready to initiate a controlled clinical trial. It's a very interesting area. And it won't be restricted, of course, ultimately to nicotine. There's no reason that this couldn't be an approach for any addictive disorder. But more than that, probably any form of radical behavioral change. So there are real fascinating implications here.
And these are small clinical trials being conducted around the United States?
Well, right now, all we have is this one pilot trial, and it's an uncontrolled pilot trial at Johns Hopkins. But the results are so promising that they really call for a controlled clinical trial. And what I suspect is that once we go ahead and report this kind of work, there'll be other probably academic sites will come in and start doing more research. But we actually need to do the research because these compounds have been so demonized culturally and within the medical and the treatment community. The first impulse is this doesn't make any sense. It sounds crazy.
Right, yeah. Great. Well, thank you so much, Roland Griffiths, okay. For your time today. We really appreciate it. Okay.